Happy Monday, everybody. You're listening to the Personal Playlist Podcast, fondly referred to as the P3. I'm Noah Daniel.
Music is a world within itself, with a language we all understand.
I am so excited to have Jason Trinh here on the Personal Playlist Podcast. Jason is a hybrid teacher, digital lead learner for the Toronto District School Board, working as a classroom teacher and as an educational technology coach. He's a Google Certified Innovator, Apple Distinguished Educator, and the recipient of the Ontario Premier's Award for Teaching Excellence, as well as the ISTE Digital Equity Award. Jason is the founder of Racialized EDU, a collective of educators curating and creating content focused on diversity and equity, and a member of Our Voice Academy. Jason is an innovative educator who shares his passion for creativity, technology, and equity as a published writer and speaker throughout North America. Welcome to the show, Jason.
Thanks for having me.
Before we hit record, we were talking a little bit about how the world has changed so much since we first booked this. And besides going through remote learning, dealing with what's happening in the world right now, you must feel an elevated responsibility with the work that you do.
Definitely. I think just how I've changed is that I'm really intentional with what I'm trying to do now. There was a great webinar series called Four Big Questions. And yeah. I was following it on Twitter. I was unable to actually watch it, but I was watching some of the tweets come out. And there was a tweet from Amit Mehrotra who was saying that there's this framework that Kiji Ojo Thompson was saying that you need to disrupt, you need to create a new path, and then you need to bring people along. And that really resonated with me, and I feel like that's how I'm trying to navigate all my different spaces. This morning, I met with my class, and I was meeting with them to say what the activities for the week were, and I created like a digital breakout for them, which I thought was a great way to end the year. And I was about to share that on Twitter. And just with how the times are now, I actually ended up not sharing it because I'm feeling this responsibility where I'm trying to use my platform and my voice to speak to things that are important. Normally I would have tweeted that post out saying like, hey, I'm doing this digital breakout. But I think my lens has changed a lot where I really want to be intentional with how I share information, what I'm sharing, because I felt that at for the times, like that doesn't need to be out there now. There are more pressing things that are happening at hand.
I think that, you know, what you're saying about really being mindful of how you curate your story and your voice in social media platforms is important now because, you know, it calls on all of us to lend our voices for a cause that's greater than ourselves. And ultimately, the purpose of education is fostering change and a better world. So I also feel an elevated sense of responsibility. And I was reflecting on some of the things that have happened or some traction I didn't get on something going, why would I even do that now, considering the context and how much has changed? So I think you make such an important point. It's actually a series that I wish I had participated in. All those people were at Quest this year speaking in a circle conversation related to not just equity, but looking at racism critically, and all four of those thought leaders are essential to move our work forward. So it's great that you caught some of the conversation around that. You are a really innovative person, and you know, I started following you a long time ago, but your Creating the Classroom series is among the things I love to follow. I feel like you're the kind of person who learns something new and models it in small doses for all of us who are following you. Were you always like that?
Yeah, I think that's sort of how my mind sort of works. Like, I think this whole ed tech world and digital creation, I sort of stumbled upon it. It was things I was doing in my personal life, but I didn't really know that this whole other world existed I was always been creative. If I learned a new skill, I would always want to master it. So I would internalize it myself, practice it. And again, talking about social media, again, it's like a perfect avenue to demonstrate and model trying and failing and putting yourself out there. So that's sort of like the idea of that series was to not be afraid to try and not be afraid to put your voice out there. And yeah, it's a way that it's just chronologized, it's been giving me a way to sort of take note of my journey. I think it's one of the benefits of social media is that if you post things, you can go back in time and sort of see who you were and how you've evolved. And even looking at that series, I see my own growth in discovering my creative voice. That whole Create in a Classroom series is really coming from the idea that anybody can create. Like, you don't need to be an artist. You don't need to be a photographer. You don't need to be, you know, a musician. If you give somebody a set of tools and you give them some input of how to do them, they can be really empowering that you can just begin to create. And you don't need to be, like, perfect to post those things. Like, a lot of the times people have some insecurities, imposter syndrome, a lot of different things that hold you back. And those are things I always want to share with my students that you need to give it a try. And those are things I always share with them that you don't know if you will be successful until you try. And I think there's nothing more powerful than modeling sort of your expectations that you have for your students and for your colleagues as well.
But that's the thing I appreciate so much, is really modeling the messiness of it and not waiting to master something in order to be on the road to doing it. So I think that that's actually very significant. And it leads me to the next conversation, because for a person like you, it must have been a fun adventure without any worry about the repercussions of choosing your three songs for your personal playlist podcast recording. So what was that process like for you?
You know what? It was sort of hard to do at first. Like, at first you're thinking about the songs. I think a lot of the things you consume now with music, the world has changed with music, where there is Spotify, there's other streaming services where music just comes to you and it just plays and it uses AI to know what you like. And so, you know, when you start a song, it will continue on. So the songs I chose really were not from current times, but really songs that I always go back to. And I think my inspiration was driving the car one day and the radio was just a bunch of like noise I didn't want to hear. So I just put on the CD player. And it played song, and it had a CD that actually had one of the songs that I selected, and it just reminded me that there was a time when I purchased CDs, and that was a time where I actually like was intentional with what I purchased and what I wanted to consume. So all my selections today were were songs that I have CDs to, because I think when you had to purchase music and you had to purchase CDs, you're really intentional with what you wanted to consume, as opposed to nowadays where everything's just streamed for you and there's AI that's selecting songs based on what you picked. You had to be really intentional about going to like the music store, finding that CD, purchasing it, taking it home. So the songs I selected were all songs really going back to that time. And I think, yeah, that was usually, and that time was in my undergrad days. And that's, I think, where I really began to carve out who I wanted to be, who I was, and really had a sense of independence. So all those songs based on identity, nostalgia, your pick-me-ups, they all come from that time where I was, figuring out my identity.
Isn't that interesting? And you picked it from a time where, I guess in some ways, you had more control over your choices. So it has a lot to do with agency, which I think is indicative of a lot of your work. Kind of mixing, or the collaboration of creativity and technology, with equity always being the lens through which that you work. So let's go to your nostalgic song, because I got to learn two new songs actually from your playlist today, which is always awesome. But your nostalgic song is so much about journeying, and it's such a vivid adventure kind of song. Why did you choose it for your nostalgic song?
It's a song I chose was Dynamite Walls by Hayden, and I think that was one of the very first concerts I went to. Like, Hayden is a Toronto artist that toured a lot within university campuses, and this song really speaks to me because it is about that journey. It's about at the time when I got into Hayden's music, it was in my undergrad days where I was on that journey, you know, trying to carve out who I wanted to be, what I wanted to do. Nobody has, like, after high school, nobody still has the answers. And I tell that to my graduating students that you have an idea of what you want to do, but there's so much ahead of you. There's this big journey, the open road. And the song really is about like that. It's like about that road trip, about just on that journey. And whenever I hear it, it just reminds me of that time where there still is possibilities. And now I'm older, you know, I have a family, I have a job, but I still feel when I hear that song, it reminds me that there is so much more possibility, that we still have choices that we can make that can shape who we are going to be.
Okay, well, let's open our eyes, put it in drive, and get on the road and just go. Here's Dynamite Wells, Hayden. Mindset, thinking about all that is ahead of you?
Yeah, like I'm not sure if anybody else does this, but whenever I travel, I always like to pick a few songs I listen to on repeat, and it always takes me back when I hear those songs again. It's almost like when sometimes you smell something with one of your senses, when you smell something or you see something, you always get reminded of those feelings and of where you were. And I feel like that with music, is that there's always certain songs that like that take you back to that place. And I do this intentionally when I go to like new places. I want to create a soundtrack of my life where there's certain songs that I have that when I hear those, it just takes me back to those moments.
It's wonderful. I've certainly heard that before, but never the intentional part. It's interesting. I've never sure for a road trip, I'll make a playlist, but I've never thought when I'm here, this is the song I want to sing. I'm going to try that. It sounds like fun. But let's talk about your identity song, because it could say a lot of different things, and I don't want to even guess. I want you to tell us when you were thinking about what song kind of tells a piece of your story or a piece of who you are at your core. Why this song by this band?
So the song I chose was Coldplay's Yellow, and it's ever evolved with this song. There's so many interesting ways that this song has sort of been connected with and shaped who I was in terms of my identity. I'll start with the most recent, which is with Crazy Rich Asians. This song was in that movie, and the backstory of it is that the director, John Cho, wanted to have it as part of it. Coldplay said no, because they thought it would, being the song Yellow, and sort of identifying that with a movie that had all Asian cast and director and writer, that it would be inappropriate. But then in this open letter, he wrote that really it's not about that, it's about reclaiming that, and that it's a part of pride and identity. And that song comes up in the movie, and it's actually performed, I think, by Catherine Ho is her name, and it's performed in Cantonese. But it was a really special moment, and watching that movie for the very first time was a really special moment. Just the idea of representation, seeing yourself on the screen, was a moment for myself. Like, you don't know what you're missing until you sort of see it with representation. And I remember just watching that movie, and there's nuanced things that I never thought I would see on the big screen. There is a scene. I'm not sure if you saw the movie, but there's a scene.
Multiple times. I actually own it. Like, we love this movie.
Yeah, there's a scene though that hit me really hard, which is a very nuanced part of it, and nothing to do with any characters whatsoever. But there's a scene in the garden when they had the party, and they're talking about this flower that blooms,
yes. I think
once in a, for how long, but that's the same flower my parents had in our living room, and I remember as a kid, my dad, like, taking the camcorder out because it was blooming in the middle of the night, because it only happens at night, and it's really fragrant. And he was like video recording it, and it was, I remember it being a very big deal. Didn't know why at the time, but then I seen this in the movie, and at the exact same time, there's also a song that was playing that I remember hearing as a kid as well. And it was just like all these other like memories and I guess emotions really just hit me, where it's like it was highlighted in this movie because there's other folks that had the same story that I had of the importance of that event. So it's not just me and my upbringing. There's a common thread with other folks that I never really connected to. So yeah, that's one piece of it where that song in a modern time really, really affected me. But then it also came out, again, it's a CD that I own. So I purchased it out. It was the very first Coldplay album. So I went to HMV and purchased it. So it's again that going back to that time where when the music you're listening to really shaping who you are in your sort of younger days is connected to it. And the third, like, the I guess another connection is this song, I used a lyric of it in my Google Innovator application, believe it or not.
Okay.
Yeah, there was a question on the application when I applied in 2017 about what's the name of, I think, it's the movie that would describe your life, and I took the lyrics "Look at the Stars," the very first set of lyrics from the song.
Look how they shine for you. Yeah.
As the name of my autobiography or my name of my movie, because again, hearkening back to the song it represents who I am. Like, it's really reclaiming that word yellow as something that's not negative, right? But really a piece of who I am. And I've been doing a lot of work just in terms of thinking about my racial identity, my ethnicity, my nationality, all these different pieces of me have been really something that I've been discovering and learning about since then. So it really is a key word. And especially at this time now, when we're looking at anti-Blackness, looking at how the model minority myth plays into promoting that and sort of unlearning and relearning things for myself about my culture, my identity, it really is sort of so many facets connected to this one song.
That is unbelievably cool. And what a wonderfully empowering experience for you in all the ways that you described it. So let's listen. Coldplay, Yellow.
Yellow. So then I took my jumped across for you. Oh, what a thing to do. 'Cause you were all yellow, a true alive.
You know, just thinking about the filmmakers asking Coldplay about, or Chris Martin about, using the song and saying no, it reminds you that, you know, when it's your choice of how you want something to go, it's a totally different experience than when it's done to you or at you. And I think that, you know, you talked about reclaiming that, the use of that term. And I see, you know, the colorblind response that people have been using and why it's so insufficient, or why people have been saying that they need to be silent because they don't know what to say. But it reminds us that we need to be listening and we need to be learning, but we also need people to tell their own stories and to have that representation so that we can learn from each other in a more authentic way, and not driven necessarily by the system, but really fostered through a system where our social identities matter.
Definitely. And I think like I grew up in Kitchener-Waterloo, not surrounded by many other people of color. Like in my elementary school, I was one of five, I think, non-white students. And it's sort of one part of my identity that I never really acknowledged or reconciled. And it was one of those things that when I went to university, I had a separate group of Asian friends, and I didn't realize sort of what I was missing. And just in terms of that, there was this understanding, where already when meeting and interacting, where we sort of understood, certain like nuanced things about family, about relationships, about sort of upbringing, and I never had that. And again, just going back to that movie, you don't know what you're missing until you sort of see and experience right. it. And that's the important part of it. Like, but yeah, like it's hard to see yourself in a third person if you're surrounded by a peer group that doesn't look like you. You don't really see that. And but race is your billboard, right? When people see you, regardless of anything that you have said to begin with, they see you, and there is a judgment that is made, whether it's implicit bias, whether it's subconscious, there is an internal dialogue we all have when we see somebody who may be different than us, maybe similar to us. Things like our brain builds a story of who that person is, and I never really reconciled that until my adulthood, where I realized that this is a part of who I am. It's part of my story. It's part of who, what makes me me, and that's what really drives a lot of the work that I do is really a parallel journey of really me discovering who I am as well at the same time, and hopefully that I'm helping others sort of do the same work that I'm doing, and we're doing this like as a team in parallel, moving in the same direction.
Yeah, I really appreciate that. All my work is about, you know, self-discovery and all the aspects that make you you. So it's important that school becomes a place where those ideas are nurtured, and where you hopefully come out not with just skills, but with a deeper sense of self. But sometimes, you know, you're feeling low or things are crazy in the world and every day is a new adventure and crazy. And sometimes it's a new adventure and we're all united in one single story, maybe for the first time. So you need a pick-me-up song. And you chose an artist also from Toronto. Why her? Why this song?
So it's Don't Get Your Back Up by Sarah Harmer. Again, another artist that I sort of fell in love with in my university days. And I just, like, this song is what I was sort of gravitated towards, because I remember moments. There's a song that's like, there's 4 hours till I need to get up again. I remember like late nights when you're like questioning everything, you know, I remember listening to the song, and that really resonated with me is that and the song really speaks to like about that you can't change everybody's mind. If they disagree with you, that's okay. Like, and everybody's entitled to their opinion. And that as a person, you can do your best to try to change things and shape things, but it's about being just authentic to yourself. And being okay that there will be people that disagree with you, and that's okay, as long as you are sort of putting your authentic self out there. Yeah, like the song, I've listened to it so many times on so many different moments, as a pick-me-up song, but it's not your, I think, not your typical energizing song, I think, but it's a song that just is almost like just it's comforting, where it's not giving you a solution, it's not, you know, pointing you to one direction, but it's just saying that things will be okay.
All right, let's play it.
Baby, if I could keep it together, don't you think I'd try? And maybe if I could make something of this, why wouldn't I? You say I close a blind eye, that I don't put up the time, but what you see is goodbye, I don't see as a crime. I'm tired of the blame being put on my head. You're breathing fire, but you're not bringing back water.
Of the song not being like a traditional pump up kind of song, but it really does send that message, like, dude, it's okay, like, ride this out or find some new perspective. And I think it's really important, especially now, to have that playlist that can help you change zones and sometimes just handle what life throws at you.
Definitely. Like, I feel like that there's so much going on in the world right now that it's really, it comes down to just your individual actions. You can't be responsible for other people's feelings. You can't be responsible for how somebody's going to respond or have to be able to change everybody's mind. But what we have control over is really just how we act, and what we do. And that's, I think, the greatest lesson of all of the stuff that's happening with COVID and anti-blackness and anti-racism that right now is that it really is that we got to be intentional with what we do. Just going back and just bookending what we talked about at the beginning is that it's about an.
I know that was quite poetic. I was going to call that. Yeah, it's exactly
the intention of what you're doing. Like little things that you do, like with COVID, it's like now thinking about when it comes a time where we're able to interact with people again. I think we're going to be really mindful of who we interact with and how we interact with them. I was talking to a colleague this morning. She sent me a message and she just wanted to talk about something. And I just responded, can we talk? And we had a good laugh about how it's been reversed now. Like I would used to love to just like text somebody, email somebody as a way to correspond. But now I'm trying to be like, if there's intention of wanting to connect through a more like interactive medium, like through a phone call. Before I hated making phone calls. That was like the one of the options I did not use my phone for. But now it's different, right? That like it's really important just to, like, who we want to connect with, how we want to connect. And I think moving through that, like with COVID and in terms of what's happening now with like anti-Black racism, it's about that intention of what we do in our classrooms, what we post, on social media, because it really is just telling it. That's one way we can act, right? And in terms of like showcasing what we believe in, how we want to sort of move through this world.
Definitely. And I'm really glad that you said that. Jason, how can people find you?
So they can find me on social media at Jason Tries, Instagram and Twitter. Those are usually my sort of initial starting points. That way they can connect with me. And I would love you if you would want to connect with me and sort of dive deeper into sort of seeing how you can take an equity lens of what you do and how you can be really intentional with how you act.
Well, thank you so much for spending time on the Personal Playlist podcast. Is there anything you want to add before I play you out?
I think I want to say thank you for having me on and giving me this opportunity to really draw attention to some key issues that are happening now. And I really want everybody to take this as a call to action that really now is the time to act. So take that time and do it.
Okay, well, thank you so much. I concur, and I hope you have a wonderful day.
Thank you.
Thank you for joining us on the P3, the Personal Playlist podcast. I'm Noah Daniel. This is Voice Ed Radio, and I hope you have a fantastic day.